If she had only been ugly, we would still be together.
This is Dom Irrera live at the Laugh Factory. How are you guys? Thank you for tuning in. Got my friend Adam Hills here, international comedian, has talk shows in Australia. We'll talk about all that today. Welcome. Come into our world. Join us. Embrace us. You got nothing better to do. Why are you, you wouldn't be looking at my fat face. How are you, my brother? Happy birthday, by the way.
Thank you very much.
It's nice seeing you and the kids.
It was my birthday yesterday.
The wife looks beautiful.
Yeah.
I mean, she's more beautiful than ever.
I think so, too.
Wow.
You were really very complimentary to her last night.
It was true.
Isn't it?
I would never say it if... The question, the compliment, like, boy, you look... You know, like, you look good. I'd rather say you look good than, well, you lost a ton of weight. You know what I mean? It's like, what, I was a ton?
But you, can I just say, as a friend, you were on the right side of complimentary to my wife without me feeling threatened.
Well, why would you feel threatened?
No, because I have a friend.
Oh, yeah.
An American friend who said to my wife in front of me, said, man, you looking beautiful tonight. And she went, oh, thank you. Went, do you know what? I just want to be in the room when you have an orgasm.
Wow.
I don't want to be the one giving it to you. I just want to be in the room when you have an orgasm.
Because that's class. Just because you're married to somebody doesn't mean I can drink in your orgasmic air.
And I'm kind of standing there next to him going, hang on, are you?
Is there, yeah.
Am I in this at all?
Is there anything called respect for the sanctity of marriage?
So thank you. I appreciate that. And of course, you are, Dom is the American comedy godfather to my daughter, my 2-year-old daughter.
She's adorable, that kid.
She has a comedy godfather in each country that is responsible, not for her. Most godfathers are responsible for, you know, moral codes and ethics for a child. You're just responsible for her comedy upbringing when she's in this country.
Well, I accept that responsibility and I appreciate it. And as far as her godfathers go, I would like to, and I'm not asking for a compliment, I'm not asking to be put down, what would the order be if her three godfathers did a show?
If the three godfathers did a show? You'd be headliner.
Yes! BB, I love you, baby! Who's your headlining godfather? Oh, man, jeez. I sweated that question out.
I tell you what, there are comedy godfathers around the world going, oh, come on, really?
You're going to close Dom?
Am I opening? Who?
With that Goomba?
Where am I on that?
With that Goomba shit? They don't get that anywhere else.
What's great is we've now, because she's just at that age, the other day I was telling her what all the phrases were that each of the comedy godfathers said.
Right.
And we were in Sydney and her comedy godfather, Dave, was biting her neck going, nom, 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 nom. So I said, what does Comedy Godfather Dave say? And she goes, he go, nom, 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 nom. And then what does Comedy Godfather Ian say? And he's Irish, you know, Ian Coppinger. And because we'd been on the phone with him the day before, and he was going, tatay, tatay, eat your potatoes.
Eat your potatoes.
So she goes, tatay, tatay, eat your potatoes. And then she now knows that Comedy Godfather Dom goes, you know what?
You know what? One of the greatest jokes of all time.
Would you... Now, I haven't heard you tell this joke for ages. Is it worth retelling for people who may not know the joke?
Yeah, I think it's a great joke. Guy goes into a pet store. There's a parrot on a perch. And the guy's walking by. The parrot goes, what does he go, fuck you?
I think so.
He goes, hey, pal, fuck you. The guy goes, what'd you say? The parrot goes, fuck you. You heard what I said. Fuck you and fuck everybody you know. He goes, I'm telling the manager. He goes, go tell the manager. And by the way, blow me and blow it out your ass, you cocksucker. He goes, I'm appalled by this. Fuck you. And he goes, I'm sorry. This parrot's cursing at me. I find it very offensive. The manager goes, stop right there. I'm sorry. Apologize. We got a problem with this parrot. Come back tomorrow as my guest. Anything you want. Free gerbil. Anything. It's yours. So the guy leaves and he goes up to the parrot. He goes, listen, you. He goes, fuck. He says, I'm telling you, cockatiel cocksucker from Colombia, I will break your beak with a nutcracker. I will strangle you. I'll pull every feather out of your fucking head. Parrot goes, all right, you don't curse anymore. All right, I don't curse. Take it easy. Chill. Next day, true story, the parrot's on the perch. The same guy comes walking by. Now he's not allowed to curse. And the guy's walking by and the parrot spots him. And the guy goes... hey, pal. And the parrot goes to him, and he goes, what? And the parrot goes, you know what. Because he couldn't say fuck.
Do you know what? Hearing
Do you like you know what or you know better?
You know what. Yeah, because yeah, the guy's
it ties
go
it
what?
Together better. Yeah, right. Yeah.
Hey, buddy, what? You know what.
You know what.
Yeah. And that joke, hearing you tell it, and I've heard you tell that maybe 4 or 5 times, and each time it's a different variation.
Oh, yeah.
It's almost like...
Like the aristocrats?
It's like the aristocrats. Yeah. It's like comedy jazz. Like there's a basic structure. You know how it's going to end. It has to end with you know what.
Well, I was the one that told Bob Saget that joke. And Bob Saget did it 22 minutes on it.
Wow.
I told him the joke, it was 3 minutes long.
Yeah.
That's how much. But I'd like when you get into the aristocrats joke, and I'm not going to tell that now because then I'll make it about me. But there are certain things that you just make up and like act like that's a reality. Because like at the end, when the family's gathering around, they all take a group dump and then they start skating in it. And I go, start skating. You know, people skating shit, right? And like as if that's, it's common knowledge to anybody.
So. Well, that's the first time I've heard you say cockatiel cocksucker when telling that
joke.
Oh,
really?
Yeah. I was like, wow. Even that, it's just a lovely little...
little alliteration.
It's like taking a classic jazz tune
and
then adding your own little tweaks and flourishes to it. God, we're comedy nerds. In a good way. In a great way.
Yeah. Well, you know what's great about comedy? I mean, I don't want to get too philosophical. It's the one thing, unless you get popped on the noggin, that you can continue to improve at until you die. No matter what Michael Jordan does, he could go to Nepal and study with the greatest, wisest men in the world. He could exercise it. He'll never be Michael Jordan again.
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
He can't go back to that. We can keep getting better.
I remember in my really early days when I was about, I think I was still doing open micers. And a friend of mine who was an actor who had taken up stand-up, and he said, do you know what I love about this? There's no use-by date. There's no date.
Oh,
there's no age at which I have to go, well, it looks like I've missed my chance. He said, I could be 80.
Oh, yeah.
And my big break could still be ahead of me.
Yeah. I remember when I was a kid, did you ever hear the Andy Griffith Show?
Yeah, yeah.
There was a guy on the Andy Griffith Show that got cast in his 80s to play a part of one of the guys at the barbershop or something. I thought... Well, there's hope for everybody. Well, Dom Chianese, the guy who plays Junior in The Sopranos, is an old friend of mine.
Right.
And he was 70 when he got the part.
Yeah. Look, you never know when your face is going to be exactly what people are looking for.
Do me a favor, and I hate to do this to you, but for the American audience, I want them to know some of your, some of the things you've done.
Oh, sure.
Some of the things you, and still do in Australia, like Spicks and Specks, which I've done in.
Well, I have to explain that to an American audience, Spicks and Specks.
Yeah. Well,
just the name alone.
I know.
It's, Spicks and Specks is a music quiz show. So it's finished up now. We did 7 seasons of it. It was 2 teams. I was the host. There were 2 teams on either side, or 1 team on either side of me. There'd be a team captain on each team, Miff Warhurst and Alan Bro. Miff was, she studied music and ended up becoming a journalist. Alan worked in a record store and became a comedy actor.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the rest of the team, we'd always have another musician, and then we would have a comedian. So Dom's been on. We've had Weird Al Yankovic, Status Quo.
Fiona Loughlin.
Fiona O'Loughlin, all the greats.
Well, we went to do the show, and Fiona Loughlin is a woman who has 5 kids from Alice Springs, Australia. And she does have some problems with alcohol. And, I mean, I love her very much, but she was so drunk. The day that she came in, they had to replace her. Luckily, there was a comedian, like an emergency comedian, within 15 minutes of the show.
I am squirming awkwardly right now because that has never been made public. No one ever knew that. This is a first, an exclusive.
Well, this is a news-breaking show. That's why people. I don't want to hurt Fiona. I love her, but it had to be said.
Yeah, well, yeah. Look, what goes on behind the scenes of TV could end up becoming...
I couldn't believe she was drunk in the afternoon.
Look, what is it about? Well, comedy makes you.
You don't drink that much, huh?
No, I remember. I lived in Ireland, so I learned how to drink, I can drink properly. Yeah.
I'm not saying you can't. Easy.
I did it. Back off,
just
buddy.
Just a podcast, tough guy.
I did a tour recently in Australia with a whole bunch of people that were on the TV show with On Spicks and Specks, and there was also a band with us, and they really drank hard early on, and I just paced myself. And at the end of the tour, they called me the Stephen Bradbury of the tour. Now, Stephen Bradbury was an Australian ice skater who won a gold medal when everybody else fell over in front of him.
Right, right.
So I was proud because I've learned through living in Ireland and through doing stand-up, I've learned how to drink. But the problem, I remember doing the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, which is 30 days of an hour-long solo show every night, as well as late-night spots.
Oh, yeah.
And I know you've done that as well. And then the following weekend, I went to Newcastle in England, and I did three nights. And each night I was drinking, I was getting up to drinking six or seven, maybe eight beers a night, waking up with a hangover.
Yeah, that's bad.
Pushing through it. What scared me was on the third night, I woke up without a hangover and went, oh, that can't be
good.
Yeah,
that's your body's absorbing it and you're getting so used to it.
So I kind of, and also there's that thing of who wants to be on stage sweating through a hangover in front of 500 people that have paid good money to see you.
Oh, I hate being drunk on stage because you, like I, are very relaxed on stage.
Yeah.
So alcohol does not, I mean, maybe one drink, but like anything that would affect your speech or any your timing, it really throws me off. I mean, it's not good at all for me. Like maybe if I was, when I started out, if I was nervous, it would help.
Yeah.
Excuse me, now it just gets in my way.
You got to have your brain. Your brain is the muscle. It's like doing something that would, if you're a sprinter, doing something that would hamper your leg muscles the night before.
Right.
But here's the weird thing. I did, the last time I was at Edinburgh, I did my show. And at the end of the show, someone from the audience bought me a pint. And I said, I will finish it at the end of the show. So I finished my hour. I downed the pint. I then had to go and do another late night show. And I got on stage and mentioned it. You know, I had just downed a pint. And then someone gave me another beer from the audience. And then it became a kind of a joke. So I ended up having another couple of beers and a couple of whiskeys. And then did a 20-minute set. What scared me the most was a friend told me the next day that one of his buddies was at the show. And afterwards, the guy said, do you know what? I never find Adam Hills funny, but last night he was hilarious.
I never find him funny. let me preface it with...
So I started to think, maybe, should I be drinking more to appeal to this audience that don't normally find me funny?
I'm so paranoid that when you said they brought you a drink from the audience, I wouldn't trust anybody. I'd be afraid they put something in it, you know?
That is, someone told me recently, that's a very American thing.
Yeah.
That American, like...
I noticed the Irish leave their drinks and go dance or go outside and have a smoke.
Yep.
Not here.
That's a really interesting thing. Someone told me that recently, that they were handed a drink in America and took a swig, and all the American friends were going, oh my God, you just drank that?
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, why wouldn't I?
Right.
Oh, no. Do you know what it was? It was Rove on stage at the Comedy and Magic Club last weekend started eating chocolate cake from someone in the audience gave him chocolate cake.
Who?
Rove McManus is an Australian comedian.
Oh, okay.
And it was the Comedy and Magic Club's birthday. Right, and someone in the audience handed him some chocolate cake and he ate it. And there were guys backstage going, I couldn't believe you ate that, man. And he was like, why wouldn't I? Like, why?
Yeah, yeah. Well, we'd be too paranoid. We'd think they put mescaline on it or something. I remember I used to say that about my wife. My wife would say to me, why would you think they would waste good drugs on you?
That is a really destructive heckle.
Yeah.
to bring up a drink with like a roofie in it. Just go, I'm not going to heckle the guy.
How come my drink's fizzing?
I'm not going to heckle him. I just want to see what happens in about 20 minutes' time.
We'll see how good he is when the walls start melting.
Oh, now I have to explain Spicks and Specks.
Oh, yeah. Oh, because of the language thing, too. Yeah.
The name of this show. Spicks and Specks is a Bee Gees song. It was their first number one hit in Australia, and I think it was 1962.
How's it go?
It goes, it's a really funny, dinky little bang, 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 dunk, 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 dunk. Where are the girls? I left.
I know it.
Far behind. The next line is, the Spicks and the Specks.
Right, right.
Are the girls on my mind.
Because can't help but do that with the Bee Gees. that first part. In the event of something happening to me, there is something. You know that song?
Yeah, yeah. Is it New York Mining Disaster?
New York Mining Disaster.
Whatever it is. Yeah. So yeah, clearly that was never going to be the right name for a music quiz show, but Spicks and Specks, because it's bits and pieces of music trivia.
Right, right.
And what we didn't realize, of course, is that Spick has a completely different meaning in America.
Well, yeah, it's a derogatory term for Puerto Ricans.
Mm.
And it's so funny when people get the wrong derogatory term. They're so ignorant, they don't even know the proper ignorant term. You know, like they'll call a Mexican a Spick.
Right.
Like, no. We'll call him a wetback if you want to make a slur, but don't call him a spick. Call, you know. You
have to a spick is for someone else, is it?
Spick is for Puerto Rican people.
Oh, I had no idea.
Yeah, like Dago is for Italians or Guinea.
Wow.
Grease ball.
See, I had no idea about that. And what was weird was...
What's an Australian? What are Australians called?
What are Australians
like
called?
Like as a negative...
Okay, in Australia we have a lot of Greek and Italian immigrants who were at the time referred to as WOGs.
WOGs?
WOGs, W-O-G.
I find that offensive. You're not coming on my fucking show calling me a WOG. Especially since I haven't heard of it less than a minute ago.
Well, what's weird is in Australia there was then a TV show of Greek and Italian comedians called WOGs Out of Work. And they kind of owned the name and it took the sting out of it. But in Britain, a WOG will often refer to a black person, and that is a horrific thing to call someone.
Yeah.
So I've been on stage in England and said to a woman, you know, where are you from? Oh, from Australia. Oh, what's your name? Oh, Debbie, what's your last name? Giannopoulos. And I go, oh, Giannopoulos. She goes, yeah, I'm a WOG.
Uh-huh.
And then the British audience go, ooh. Man. You go, no, hang on. She's referring to herself as a term that Australian Greek, oh, man.
What nationality would you say you're ethnically?
Actually, that's really interesting. I would say Australian, but I know that my great-grandparents on my mother's side, one came from Austria and one came from Malta.
Wow.
So, you know, my mum has memories of her grandmother saying, don't stay away from the chickens, and like actually having an accent. Right.
She sounds like somebody from Monty Python. Was she Eric Idle?
my great-grandmother was Eric Idle. But the weird thing about Spicks and Specks is that...
It was a great show, by the way. I really enjoyed doing it.
Oh, it was fun because it was an actual music quiz.
I had a ringer, too. I had that 22-year-old girl, beautiful. She was just... You know, you do so many shows, it's hard for you to remember, but she was so fucking good.
Who were you sitting next to? Who was it?
I don't know. It was two women.
Yeah.
And myself, I was closest to the audience.
Yep.
And she was in the middle, and she just took over. And
wow. You know, I remember where you were.
Locomotive. It was, yeah. Because I didn't know a lot of that. I knew some, you know.
But do you know what? That was the kind of show where it was best if the comedian didn't know much about music.
Yeah.
Because then you would go with the funny.
Right, like, right.
Ross Noble, as an English comedian, came on early on and he said, I'm really sorry at the end. I stopped being funny because I started trying to win.
Oh.
Yeah. So, but what's weird is I showed an episode of that to an American producer a few years ago or gave it to him. And the next day he said, hey, Adam, he said, I watched that Spicks and Specks last night. And I got to tell you, man, I don't get it.
Really?
And I went, what do you mean? He went, wow. It's just people talking, right? And I went, yeah. And he went, and people watch that?
Well, aren't talk shows that?
But there were no bells and whistles. There was no, you know, for 8:30 at night on a Wednesday.
I thought it was a great show.
Yeah, it was, you know, look.
And what's the show you're working on now? I didn't mean to interrupt. Say where you...
I just want to finish with Joan Rivers came to Australia to present at the Australian TV Awards. So on live television, she was probably on about 10 o'clock at night. So it's still prime time.
Yeah.
She walks out on live television on Australia with a host who says, Miss Rivers, it's a pleasure to have you here. And she went, you know what, Richard? I don't know who the fuck anybody is here.
Wow.
Live on air. And looks at, and you know, huge laughs in the room. And she goes, I'm sure you're all very talented and lovely. I have no fucking idea who you are. People, oh my God, we can't believe she said fuck on live television. Oh, it was amazing. She went, okay, so the nominees for Best Light Entertainment are Dancing with the Stars. And then she looked at Spicks and Specks and went, oh, I can't say that on television.
Really?
She wouldn't say it.
Wow.
She was okay dropping the F-bomb three times in a row.
That's interesting.
But she wouldn't
say... She could say fuck, but
she wouldn't say Spicks and Specks.
Oh.
And then the topper is it was released as an app for your iPhone, the Spicks and Specks, last year. And it was you could download it and you could play music trivia on your iPhone. But because Apple is based in America, when they submitted it, they censored the name. So it was released in Australia as S blank 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 S and Specs.
Wow.
Which means everyone in Australia thought it was a game called Shits and Specs.
That's funny.
So that was the music quiz show. And then now I host a talk show called Gordon Street Tonight, which is filmed in the ABC.
Is that in Melbourne?
In Melbourne, yeah.
But you live in Sydney?
No, I live in Melbourne now.
Oh, you do? Do you live in Sydney?
I grew up in Sydney.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And started doing comedy there.
Where did you meet Ali?
On Sphix and Sphex, actually.
Really?
She, well,
she's a good singer.
She's a trained opera singer. She was a soprano with Opera Australia.
I'd love to hear her sing. You know what I'd like to do, too? I'd like to be in a room with her while she's singing. Just a room, that's all.
I've been at a party with her, and it was actually here. It was in Topanga years ago, and there was a group of people. You know, people getting out bongos, and they're playing the bongos, and people are strumming a guitar, and there's a bit of a beat going around the room, uh-huh. And there's a bit of a jam. And she was looking at me going, should I? And I went, I don't know, should you? And I really hadn't known her that long at this point. And then just to add to all the jamming that was going on, she started improvising opera. Wow. So she was singing opera, but just improvising around what they were doing. And like every jaw in the room just dropped.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh my God. That's
such a gift.
It's like scat opera. I've never seen that done before. So yeah, it's amazing that, you know, she has this incredible talent. Yeah. And that she will still follow me around the world to do comedy gigs.
But isn't it interesting that... you both can't do what the other one can do.
Yeah.
So it seems like, you know, I'm sure she looks at you and goes, how does he think of stuff like that? Oh, my God. You say, you know, I could never do that. Yeah. I always love these people who think that stand-up's the hardest thing in the world.
Yeah.
You know.
Especially when it's people like, you know, songwriters. Like, I'm amazed by people who can write a song,
Musicians love comedians.
Yeah.
And they want to be comedians. It just and we all want to be musicians. It's a part of us, you know.
It's the people who go... you know, I could never get up on stage with a mic and just talk to an audience. And I go, well, I could never write a song.
Yeah. Oh, well, that was funny what you... I quoted you when you said about yesterday, about he wrote yesterday about McCartney.
Oh, yeah.
Because there was a guy who's a friend of mine. He's a security guard at Harvard.
Right.
Right? And he's putting McCartney down. And he was saying, he shouldn't sing some of those songs anymore. I said, man, you got some set of balls. Putting him down. I said, it was a friend of mine once said, no matter what, he wrote yesterday.
Yeah.
I said, you are a security guard at a fucking college you could never get into. Do you protect people who are all better than you and you got the balls to cut up Paul McCartney? But what was the context of what you said it about yesterday?
That was on an episode of Sphix and Sphex.
Oh, was it?
It was a guitarist by the name of Steve Lukather who played guitar for Toto. But Toto, you know the band Toto. Yeah. That's it. I bless the rains down in Africa. Yeah. What people don't realize is that Toto was made up at the time of a whole bunch of session musicians who got together and went, man, we should form a band.
Yeah.
And they are hard rock. Like Steve Lukather is one of the best guitarists in the world, firstly. He turned up Sphix and Sphex. He had been drinking with In Excess the night before. And had been
drinking in excess with in excess.
He had been carried out of the bar by the Toto's bouncer.
Uh-huh.
So he was hungover. He had decided he was going to try and set the record for the amount of times the F-bomb was dropped on our show, and he did. They were all edited out, but he did. He's a proper rock dog.
Yeah,
people don't realize that about Toto, and what they also don't realize is because
does he sing lead too? Or just played the
I don't think so. No, I don't think so.
They're one of those bands. I never knew anybody's name.
Yeah, no, no one did because there was session musicians.
Right.
But he played. I read through a whole list of albums that he played on, and I said, you know, what did you do on Paul McCartney's? He said, I did. Give My Regards to Broad Street. I played on the whole album, and I went, all right. And what about, you know? I think he played on a Madonna song, and I think. And then I said, Michael Jackson, and he went, oh, I played the guitar riff on Beat It. And we went, oh, wow.
Wow.
And then someone went, ho. He said, not the solo. The solo was Eddie Van Halen.
Oh, right.
Said, and someone, it was one of the comedians went, hang on, so when I listen to Beat It and I just hear, and he went, yep, that was my sorry ass.
That was him?
I was more impressed by that than if Michael Jackson had been on the show.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? To go, that's, every time I hear that song, I go, I've met that guy.
I know.
That actually played that riff. So we were talking, and then someone started dissing Paul McCartney. And he went, hey, leave Paul McCartney alone. I played with him.
Right.
And everyone was going, yeah, but come on. One of the guys went, come on, but some of the songs he plays now, and blah, 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 same thing. And he went, hey, the guy wrote yesterday. He can do whatever the hell he wants for the rest of his life. And everyone went, that is
amazing. He wrote it as a teenager, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Think of that. Think of, like, the Menudo and all these boy groups, groups that come up and they're gone.
Yeah.
They were that age when they wrote those songs.
And you know, the great bit of trivia about yesterday is that he came up with the melody, but not the words.
Right. Like scrambled eggs.
He scrambled eggs.
Yeah.
So I think it was scrambled eggs. Oh, my darling, how I love your legs.
Oh, really?
That was the first line.
I like that better than yesterday. Makes more sense to me.
Because I forgot you're a massive Beatles fan, aren't you?
Yeah. Well, I was on tour with Cher, and this guy who was the merchandiser, his name was like Fritz or something like that. He was a great guy. And every night before the show, I'd have a glass of wine. He'd have a Jack and Coke. Right. Before I went on, and I said, "Who else have you worked with?" You know, and he says, "You know, he named a couple people. He named McCartney." I said, "Oh, I'm a big Beatles fan." He said, "McCartney." He goes, "Dom, he was a fucking gentleman." Then he pauses. He goes, "He's very talented, you know." I go, "Well, can you tell me McCartney's talented?" "Yeah, he kind of had his day in the sun." "Well, he's a good singer. He could write. He could write a little. Plays a little bass. He's very talented." It's like saying Bolt is very fast. That Bolt, he can run.
See, that's the thing that amazes me here is that, I don't know if the tradition still goes, but so many comics that I've met who opened for massive music acts.
Yeah.
Like that would never happen in Australia, but you opened for Cher.
Yeah, but Cher is very different than a regular musical act.
Right.
Because she's such a broad career that you get grandmothers with their granddaughters and transvestites.
Yeah.
I mean, she's this spectrum of people that come, because they remember her from Sonny and Cher, from Moonlight? What was it? Not Moonlight. You know,
it'll come. Not Moonshadow either.
Moonshine? Moon.
Moonshine, that was the one.
Moon Age Daydream. Moonstruck.
Thank you.
But anyway, they remember from that. Yeah. So, you know, it was very easy to open for her.
Right.
I mean, I had trouble. Only on the outdoor gigs, the ones, the amphitheater.
Wow.
Because they were like, because people were picnicking and all. It wasn't anything against me, but they're still eating and stuff. Like the Starplex in Dallas was tough.
Yeah.
I thought, I don't know if I can do this. And then the next night we go to the Houston Summit where the Rockets used to play, and it was great.
But like how many people, even at the Houston Summit, for instance?
Well, it was probably not as full as it could be for basketball because we had part of it blocked off.
Yeah.
I would say, you know, 15, 16,000.
But how, like, this, and so this is what I can never get my head around. So 15, 16,000 people have turned up to see Cher. Okay, they've bought the tickets, they know yeah. Cher's on the bill.
But they know I'm on the bill,
too.
They
know you're on the bill?
She was nice enough to, yeah, I was always on the bill.
Right, okay.
So it wasn't like, oh.
Great, okay.
You know, I was doing Conan O'Brien one night, and Springsteen was there. He came to see Max, who plays drums for him. And he came over to talk to me, and he said, you ever open for rock people? I said, well, I would never open for you. Not a chance. And he goes, why? I said, because all it would be was a fucking disappointment. I said, all it would be was the lights go down, curtain comes up, and they're all going Bruce, and then I'm standing there with a mic, man. We said Bruce, we didn't say you. Go back to Slappy Bananas, pal. No, but I mean, you know what I mean? Like, I opened for Joan Jett and the Blackhearts one night when I first started out.
Yeah.
The guy hands me $250. He goes, stay on as long as you can, right?
Wow.
There's an endorsement. And I was on for maybe 3 minutes. I got some laughs. I had 2,000 people laughing, 2,000 people going, we hate you, Joan. Joan Jett and the Blackhearts, right?
Yeah.
So somebody tossed just a little top of an ice cream container. I saw it on the stage. As soon as I see that somebody tossed something, I'm out of there.
Right.
And the guy goes, you did great. I go, I was only on for about 2 or 3 minutes. He goes, nobody stays on that long. I said, what do they do, fucking run by? I said, why do you even have a musician? Yeah, because it's a band chance to warm up.
Wow.
I mean, you know, to tune up.
Yeah.
But that was bad. Have you ever been on any one of those?
That just made me think of a gig I did in Belfast. In Northern Ireland. Did you ever play the Empire?
I've never been to Belfast.
Oh, wow. The first time I ever played, I was support act. So I was, you know, the MC went out, blah, 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 and here's Adam Hills. So I went out. In the first maybe 3 or 4 minutes, I was getting laughs. And then they just stopped listening and started talking for the next 10 minutes.
Wow.
They started talking. And then I think I was booked for about 20. The last 3 or 4 minutes, they started to laugh again. And I just walked off stage dejected. And the club owner came up to me and said, that was amazing. Next time you can headline.
Wow.
And I went, but I lost them for 10 minutes in the middle. And he went, Oh, okay. What happens here is the audience turn up purely to watch the opening act die. He said, after about 3 or 4 minutes, when they realized you weren't dying,
they were listening.
They got bored.
Oh, really?
And they stopped listening.
What a bizarre world that is.
They started talking. He said, and then towards the end, when they realized you were still going and you were doing okay, they started listening again. He said, so
that's hilarious.
You pass. Next time you can come back and headline.
God. I remember opening up for Cher in Milwaukee. It was 27,000 people. It was called the Milwaukee Summer Fest.
Yeah.
So it was half inside, then it went outside. The stands, really big venue, obviously 27,000. And I go out. And the guy comes to me. He goes, listen, Dom, I'm sorry we have to start the show. I thought it'd be dark by now. I go, what do you mean you thought it'd be dark by now? It's not arbitrary. Did you ever hear the Farmer's Almanac? It's not like, oh, tonight it got dark at 2:30 in the afternoon. Yesterday it got dark at 8:30. I'm thinking, the guy started laughing after he said that. And I go out and I thought, how am I going to do this? So I thought, I know what I'll do. And this is how weird perspective. I go, I'll just play to the 10,000 people in front of me. Fuck the 17,000 that are behind them. It's too early. It's just, I mean, I never went out with sunglasses before. And I started like busting the bouncer's balls and doing stuff like that. And, it worked.
Right.
But it was intimidating. But by that time, once you do those arenas, there's nothing that can really throw you. And Madison Square Garden threw me a little because of the history of it.
Right, yeah.
I mean, I did, the show is fine. But I didn't want to look up. I didn't want to look up at the banners of the Rangers and Knicks and all that shit and think of Ali and Frazier fighting there, Sinatra, all the things that happened at the Garden, John Lennon's concerts and, But that's the only one. Any place you were particularly intimidated?
Do you know what? Later this year, I think I'm going to be just doing something at the Sydney Opera House.
Wow.
And if that does come off, I think that'll be
one of the most famous buildings in the world.
Yeah, yeah.
When that's what people think of when they think of Sydney.
Mm. And because I grew up in Sydney.
Yeah,
like that's the pinnacle for me of my hometown.
Cool. Yeah.
So if I actually get to do something at the Opera House, I think I'll have a moment. But you know what?
Funny, the pinnacle for you is the Opera House. Pinnacle for me is Tropicana. But I love it. I did the Tropicana in casino in Atlantic City. It was my favorite gig ever for those kind of gigs.
It's the things, it's the venues, I think, that you looked at when you were a kid.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that you looked up to and went, I could never play there.
Well, that's unbelievable, isn't it? You'd never put... You know what it puts in perspective, I think? There was a billboard. I was going across the Philadelphia in, from Pennsylvania, New Jersey. There was a billboard of me. And, it didn't really faze me, but I thought, suppose it was your friend Bill Levin on the billboard. You go, holy shit, Bill's on a billboard. You know what I mean? And that's when it puts it in perspective, how kind of cool and different it is.
For me, it's when I see, I live in Melbourne now, which is, it's not my hometown. I grew up in Sydney. But I'll open the paper in Melbourne and I'll see an advertisement for my TV show, or I'll be in the, a picture of me in the paper or for something. And I kind of go, oh, yeah, right, that's what I do now. It's only when I'm back in Sydney, sitting on my parents' couch, and I open the...
Yeah.
And go, oh, my God. Oh, wow, I made it to there from here.
Well, I saw you in the plane. I saw you in an advertisement on the plane before I met you.
Right, really? Remember?
Yeah, Sophie and I were flying over to London.
Yeah.
And then we were going to come to Kilkenny. And she goes, oh, this guy's, we knew who your face was, but I don't think I knew you yet.
Do you know what? The real full circle for me was one of the first comedians I ever heard. In fact, the first time I fell in love with stand-up was on a plane. Because my dad worked for Qantas, so we used to have family holidays. And the first family holiday we went on, I think I was 8 or 9. And I remember listening to the in-flight comedy channel and listening to Victor Borga.
Oh, wow.
And going, oh, my God, this is a man just talking and people are laughing.
Yeah.
And I listened over and over. And that's in the days when it was on cassette, so it would play for 40 minutes and then rewind for 20.
Right.
And then it would start all over again. And I listened over and over and absolutely fell in love with stand-up. And I've always had this connection to the in-flight comedy channel.
Mine was Woody Allen.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just thought he was so hilarious. He couldn't afford a dog, so he bought an ant, called it Spot. Remember any of that stuff?
I remember the moose.
Yeah, I shot a moose. What was the one? I was walking down the street when a berserk... I put a bullet in my breast pocket. Walking down the street, a berserk evangelist heaved a Gideon Bible out a hotel window, striking me in the chest. Had it not been for the bullet, the Bible would have gone through my heart.
Do you know what? I watched the documentary. There's a documentary made about
it. I heard. I want to see that. Amazing. Yeah.
I watched that on the plane on the way over here, actually. And what amazes me is that he never set out to be a stand-up comic.
He hated it. I knew his manager, Charlie Jaffe.
Right, yep.
I didn't know Jack Rollins, but I knew Jaffe, and Jaffe and I had become friends. He used to throw up for shows. He hated it. He never was comfortable.
I mean, when I started out, I used to throw up before shows.
Really?
Do you know what? Twice I threw up before a show. But it wasn't because I hated it.
I threw up after a show because my work's so bad. Maybe not.
I have actually thrown up during a show. I was on tour in Northern Ireland and I had got stomach virus of some sort. And I wasn't sure I could make it through the show. I did 20 minutes. I was supposed to do 2 40-minute halves. I did 20 minutes and then said to the audience, look, I'm going to call an early interval. I'll come back. And I told them, I'm not feeling well. Right. I may have to run and throw up. Called an interval, ran off, heaved, came back, and went, okay, welcome to the second half. And then literally 15 minutes in went, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to have to call another interval.
Oh,
and they cheered. They went,
that you were coming back.
Ran off. And came back and then did the last, 25 minutes or something.
I shit my pants about 60% of the time. other than that, nothing affects me. Depends, you know what I'm saying, big boy? It depends.
Do you know, I was talking to a friend who's a musician. She writes songs, but she's never really performed them. And she said, I just don't have the courage to get up on stage and put them in front of strangers. And she said, I get nervous. And I went, well, I get nervous doing stand-up. She said, yeah, but I get so nervous, I feel like I'm going to be sick. And I said, yeah, sometimes I get so nervous, I feel like I'm going to be sick. And she said, then why do you do it? I said, because the alternative is to not do it.
To work.
Well, I meant that the alternative was that I never do it. Like, not doing stand-up is way more painful to me than the fear of of getting up there.
Well, you never look like you're nervous. I'm surprised. I mean, I brought you up in Montreal. You couldn't have been calmer, or at least in appearance.
I go really, but I keep it all in. Like, I remember early days, I used to turn up to gigs before people, knew who I was. And, venue owners would go, you're the comedian? And I'd just be really quiet going, yep. And you could see them going, this guy's going to be awful.
Boy.
And of course, I was just holding it all in. Yeah, and then you get on stage. But you know that. I've done it. I'm sure you've done it. Like, there was a gig in Edinburgh called Late and Live.
Yeah, I
remember that.
Yeah.
Started at 1:15 in the morning.
Yeah.
And was billed as the comedy abattoir because it's where comedians went to die. And I would remember, a few years I emceed it. And I said, I want to learn how to play the toughest room in the world.
Yeah.
Because it was horrible, drunken Scottish people.
I know. I remember I got a standing ovation there once. I don't get many standing ovations because I was so angry at the way they treated this guy.
Right.
And then I found out that's the way they treated him for fun.
Right.
That he was a kind of like real geeky guy with beard, scruffy glasses, skinny. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Daniel Kitson?
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It was one of those rooms that they just loved to hate you.
Yeah.
And I went, well, if I can MC this room, then I can do any room in the world. And I remember, the opening music was a Marilyn Manson track. So I'd be standing backstage and the owner, the venue manager would say, you ready? And I'd go, yeah. And then you just hear this like, the beautiful people. And the crowd would go, rah! And I would literally be facing a wall and kicking it, just kicking it over and over, going, what am I doing this for? What am I doing this for? And then as soon as I heard, were you ready? Rah! Welcome to the stage. Rah! And I go, oh my God. And then you'd hear, Adam Hills. And then suddenly you just go, game face on, and then walk out. No one on stage, no one in the audience saw that fear.
Sure.
But, you
knew they can sense it like dogs can sense it.
Yeah.
If you're really afraid.
Yeah.
I remember doing a gig in Melbourne and it was there late and it was the same thing, that late night thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And I met Fiona for the first time and she said to me, my manager says you're the best comedian in the world. I go, well, first of all, there's no best comedian in the world.
Yeah.
It's not like the 100-yard dash. It's so subjective.
And secondly, he's right.
And no, wait. And then I go on and I fucking tank, right? And I get off and I couldn't get them. I mean, it was me or them or a combination, whatever. And I go, hey, so much for the best comedian in the world, huh?
Do you know what, though? There would be, what you just said then is probably a great lesson for people starting out. Like, do you remember the first couple of times, probably a lot of times, that you tanked? I don't know if you ever tanked in the early days.
You didn't have to say a lot of times. You could have just ended it with the first couple of times. You see,
okay.
you see what I mean? I mean, you have like a dig to you that, you know, you have this personality, this talk show host personality, but then you can be very cruel.
I was more thinking about myself. I was going to say the first couple of times I tanked and then went, not just the first couple, like a lot of times, I would, you'd go home and go, that's it, that's the end of the world. Like, yeah, I shouldn't be doing this job. Oh my God, I'm hopeless at this. And now to hear you go, I tanked. I don't know what it was, them, it was me.
Yeah.
It happens. Oh, yeah.
I mean, there are situations now where we do so much stand-up and we've done so much that your bottom is raised up.
Yeah.
Like, so, you know, you might have like a bad set for you, but generally, given a fair chance, we're not going to bomb anymore.
Yeah.
Not really bomb.
You'd hope, yeah.
It can be, I mean, it's not going to be like crickets or any of that shit. It's just, it's a matter of levels.
You'd hope. You know? I mean, you know, I'm touching wood as I say that because, yeah, I would, you know. You never know when the next.
Oh, well, I mean, especially because we're shot out of a cannon. I mean, it's like I did a film last week and I was thinking, fucking film is so boring, but it's so easy compared to stand up because they keep doing it over and over.
Right.
The director said to me, he goes, look, let's get one down that says what it says on the paper.
Yep.
And then just improvise. I said, great. And I thought, how cool is that?
Wow, right.
And then you just keep doing it. I mean, we can't. Hey, folks, can I take that joke over again? I didn't say it right. I
heard a story about Ewan McGregor. You know the actor Ewan McGregor?
Yeah.
Scottish actor.
Uh-huh. I thought you said Ewan McGregor.
Ewan.
I'm thinking, me and McGregor? What the hell are we doing? A comedy team I don't remember?
That's the follow-up to With Nail and I, Ewan McGregor.
Right.
Ewan McGregor, the actor, had turned up to the London Comedy Store because he knew someone that was on and was kind of sitting backstage. And one of the comics, this is a story I heard, one of the comics said to him, why don't you come up on stage and introduce the next act? And he went, no, man, I'm an actor. This is not what I do. And he went, you don't have to be funny. He said, I will just bring you out. All you have to do is say, ladies and gentlemen, your next act is blah, 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 and just enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And he went, no, and then he talked him into it. And he went, all right. So the comic went out, the MC, and ladies and gentlemen, I was going to introduce the next act, but we've got a special guest star. Would you please welcome Ewan McGregor? And the place goes wild, like 400 right. people just right. on their feet. Oh, my God. Ewan gets up and, you know, says something. And, of course, they laugh. And he says something else, and they laugh again.
Now he's starting
and then
to feel
goes,
it.
Wow, okay, here's your next act, and introduces the next act.
No.
Walked off stage into the green room and went, I get it. I understand why,
you
want to
do it. Oh, yeah, the rush is incredible.
Because even, do you know what it occurred to me? Even when you're sitting in the audience never feel the rush that we get. Because we get it
that
because
wave.
Everyone's facing us.
Yeah.
When you're in the audience, if you're in the front row, everyone's behind you.
We used to get everyone facing us, but with smoke too. That was a nightmare. You know, now it's so great without the smoking thing. But yeah, and you know what's cool? It's like, I'm talking to an 18-year-old girl from UCLA.
Yep.
And I even said to this girl, I said, when am I going to get a chance to talk to you? When is a Guido head of mine going to get a chance to have you laughing and happy? I know that we're never going to get together. I know that. I'm realistic about it. But just the fact that I could chat with you without you going, get lost, pops. You know?
And not only that, she's looking at you with a look of, you know, at least admiration.
Yeah,
at the very, you'd hope.
Yeah. You hope not for repulsion. As long as she's not looking at me and repulsed. It is. It's very sexy kind of energy, the stand-up. Because it's, and you know, we talk about men and women and why there aren't as many women stand-ups and all, but to me, it's a very male-driven occupation. And I'm not saying there aren't plenty of funny women.
Yeah, yeah.
There are. There's certainly like brilliant female comedian acting.
Mm.
But I think guys have it easier.
Do you know what? A female comic once said to me, and this made perfect sense. She said one of the reasons that she thought there weren't as many female comics is because of the lifestyle. Like,
yeah, that's true.
Who wants to spend every weekend in a crappy hotel?
Well, yeah, and they can't be. They have to be protected more. They can't stay at a condo alone, say, and
right.
And then they can, and or they're with two mooks that, you know, and if the guys get drunk enough, they're going to kick in your door and throw a move on you.
Yeah. But even just more the point where she said, I want to settle. Like, I want to have a home. And she said, I'm quite domestic and I love stand up, but I don't want to be away from home more often. You know, I don't want to be away from home 3/4 of the year, which kind of makes perfect sense. And actually, a friend of mine, Hannah Gadsby, who you know, Hannah, who's on my talk show, she came up with the theory that men do stand up in the way that they have sex, which is it's really all about getting to the end. Like, it's all about the punchline.
Right, right.
Get the punchline. Get to the punchline. Whereas women like to, when they do stand up,
they like foreplay.
Yeah.
But not being funny, just explaining
spend some
it.
Time, you know.
Ease into it.
It's all about easing into it. It might go for longer. It doesn't have to be short and sharp and bang and get off.
Yeah. No, I've seen her actually not, you know, not get many laughs, but with a big round of applause at the end.
Right.
Almost like they were judging her in a different way than...
Do you know, I've...
That was my nice way of saying she tanked but still got a good hand.
God, I don't think that's just... I've done that. Do you ever have those gigs where...
I can't believe sometimes... First of all, both times, both ways. I've had sets where I think, my God, and they were done applauding by the time I hit the end of the stage. And then I've done sets where, oh, what a shit set that was. And then they're like cheering.
Yeah.
You can't, it's unpredictable.
And you kind of get to the end and go, why did you save all this up until the end?
Yeah.
And then the other, you go, well, this is a standing ovation gig. There is no way they're going to let me leave this stage. And you go, thank you and good night. And they go, oh, all right then. Well, that was it. Where's the effigy?
Now, do you feel a difference here than there when you go on stage here?
In the,
you get
in
the same results, same reaction?
I'm learning here. It's more about, look, in Australia, there's a specific put down in Australia that I've only ever heard in Australia, and it's a try hard. To call someone a try hard means you're trying too hard.
Right.
And I think Australian audiences don't like a try hard in a comedian. They don't like it if you perform your act.
Yeah, yeah.
They want you to look like one of their mates that's in the corner of the bar. If you go out to an Australian audience and go, come on, people, yeah. They just go, nah, mate.
I hate that shit.
Don't like it. In London, you've got to be, you know, bang, bang, bang. It's like the London audience is going, get to the laughs and get to the laughs now.
Mm-hmm.
Here, I found anyway, especially in LA, they like a bit more of a performance. If you look at, like, you're just, for me anyway, it feels like if I just wander out with the casual attitude I have in Australia, the audience kind of go, this guy isn't even trying.
Right, right.
You know, whereas in Australia, they go, dude, you're trying too hard. So I have to learn when I come to the States to ramp it up a little bit.
How about the content? Do they get the...
I'm surprised at what people are shocked by here.
Like what?
Trying to think. I used to have a joke about... something about gay guys in the army. Was it that? Or was it something about gay priests? And it really wasn't a racy line. But I remember doing it and the audience going, oh! It's like, wow, that is really not shocking back home. Mm. There's less swearing on stage here, I've noticed.
Really?
I think so, yeah. But mainly because a lot of people go on stage with sets that they want to do on TV.
Well, there's a lot of TV here, yeah. So
yeah.
That's for sure.
So people are trying to keep it clean.
Do you have comedians?
Is there a ghost?
I don't know.
Is this, by the way...
This was Groucho Marx's office.
I was about to ask you that.
Yeah.
Is this, because I'm a huge Marx Brothers fan.
Yeah.
Like I have at home on my wall, I have an artist contract from, I think, 1972 signed by Groucho Marx that I bought at an auction. That's my favorite possession in the world. I'm such a Marx Brothers fan. There are still two movies of theirs that I haven't seen.
You're saving them?
Because I'm saving them.
Are you really?
I love.
I'll tell you if I've seen them.
Horse Feathers? I don't think. No, A Day at the Races I haven't seen.
I've seen that.
Maybe that's the only one. Actually, I think it is. A Day at the Races is the only one I haven't seen. And
You got to see Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein. It's amazing that they would meet Frankenstein.
But so this building was Groucho Marx's office.
Yeah, I think that half of it.
Wow.
The half of it. I think then this was broken out. But that's the original building back there.
Right.
And who goes there? Who goes there? Topeka?
Oh, what? I was just really hoping the voice from the back was going to go, never mind me, just get on with the podcast.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah, state of mind. You know, I had dinner with his son at the Friars Club.
Right.
And it was so weird because he has the same voice. and the same cadence as Groucho.
Yeah.
And he was telling me the story about, remember when he said, I don't want to be a member of any club that would have me?
Yeah.
You know where that came from?
Was it a golf course? Was it a golf club?
Yeah. Anti-Semitism.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Because what happened was, he was refused a membership because he was Jewish.
Yep.
Then when he became famous, they wanted to have him. And he says, no, I don't want to be a member of any club that would have me.
Yeah.
But that was a classic.
Wasn't that also the one where he said, well, my son's half Jewish. Can he go into the pool up to his waist?
Really? That's funny.
But you know what? I met Arthur Marx as well.
Oh, really?
When I was 19, my family.
I know Sean Penn.
Sorry?
I know Sean Penn. Come on, bring it on. Don't be that Mel Gibson shit either.
No, I've got nothing. I've got nowhere else to go now.
No, Paul, go.
Haven't even met Paul Hogan. No, I haven't met Paul Hogan.
Let me call him. Call him on his personal cell.
89, my family came over here for a family holiday. And we went to Universal Studios. And was it 89? I think it was 89, yeah. And it was it happened to be Groucho's 99th birthday. And they were having a Groucho Marx impression competition. And they didn't have enough people. And they came up to our family and went, look, we're doing this thing. Where are you from? We went, Australia. And they went, it'll be hilarious. An Australian trying to pretend to be Groucho Marx. We'll put the glasses on. And I went, I'm not even, like, people were dressed up. And they said, we'll give your whole family a free day at the park. And I went, fine. So I got on and put the glasses on and then did it. And Arthur Marx was judging.
Oh, really?
And all I had to say was, you know, one morning I shot an elephant in my pajamas. How I got in my pajamas, I'll never know. That was it. And I think because I actually didn't do it with an Australian accent, we got a free day at the park. And so I went straight.
You won?
No, God, no. No, oh. there were people dressed up like
that. Oh, well.
I did like a tracksuit top right. And jeans and runners and a nose and moustache. So I started talking to Arthur Marx afterwards and same thing. I was kind of looking at him going, oh my God, I've seen photos of you. You've got the same voice as Groucho. Yeah, yeah. And my mum said, I'll take a photo. And I went, oh, brilliant. But instead of going, okay, both of you stop, look at me and smile. She just took a photo while we were talking. And I've got the most awkward look on my face because I was mid-sentence and looked like I was having a stroke midway through the photo. And that's the only photo I've got of me and Arthur Marx.
Well, at least you got a photo of him.
Yeah.
It was weird because I was at a dinner. We were doing a tribute to Sid Caesar.
Wow.
And all these old famous guys were there.
Yeah.
And my friend McGettigan, did you hear about the Sandusky case?
No.
Sandusky is a guy who molested all these kids at Penn State University.
Right.
And it's a horrible, horrible thing. And it's unfolding still. And he got convicted. He got 410 years. But on good behavior, 400 even. They're going to let him. But anyway, my friend McGettigan prosecuted that case. So it's his first day out here. And I take him to this thing, this tribute to Sid Caesar.
Right.
And Milton Berle was at our table.
Yeah.
And Milton Berle was such a wise ass. He says, yeah, I played Philadelphia. He goes, and my friend goes, oh, you really did? He goes, no, I didn't. I'm bragging about playing Philadelphia. Like that kind. So I said, is there anybody here you want to meet? And because this is where Marx was sitting at our table.
Yeah.
And he said, yeah, I'd like to meet Jonathan Winters. Wow. I said, all right, let's go. And Jonathan Winters is sitting in the corner by himself, and he's got that face, you know. And this is all our whole exchange with Jonathan Winters was, I said, hi, Jonathan. And he goes, and you call yourselves Marines? And that was it. I said, take care. That's about all we're going to get out of him. Thank you. Nice to meet you.
That is a better story, though, for your friend than if he had sat down and had a lovely chat with
you. Oh, yeah. It would ruin the whole thing.
Yeah. God, I forget that. Well, no, I don't forget that with you. I remember that with you. But every now and then it comes out again, the echelon of stand-up comics. Well,
because I'm at the age where I knew the old guys, too.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Before they all start... the dying off, but like Red Buttons, his 80th birthday party, he did a half an hour of the most perfect stand-up I've ever seen. And that's why when I was saying at the beginning of the show how we can keep getting better, he was my incentive and my hope to get better.
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't waste a word. Just perfect stand-up.
And like current and
killed
new.
Yeah. Everything mixed.
Yeah.
I never remember his, I don't know if you remember his hook was, I never had a dinner.
No.
Never had a dinner. You know, the Shah of Iran, he had a dinner. You know, whatever it was, they never had a dinner. But very funny. Yeah, it was cool. It's cool meeting those guys. I was on a dais with Martin Landau, George Segal, and Charles Bronson.
Wow.
It was a roast for Mickey Rooney.
Right.
And I said to Charles Bronson, I said, man, it's really cool to meet you. I said, you know, I've always been a fan of yours. He doesn't even look at me. He goes, hand me that napkin, will you? I'm like, oh, this is so cool. Charles Bronson, he's so rude. I love it, right? And I go, yeah, you know, that's so Bronson, the Dirty Dozen and whatever, you know, Death Wish.
Yeah.
So I go up on the podium, and I'm doing the roast, and I'm roasting everybody, and I tell the story about Bronson not even acknowledging me. I thought it was so cool, so fucking cold, you know.
Yeah.
So I go to sit down, and he goes, listen, man, I'm sorry. I can't hear out of this ear. I was like, it ruined the whole thing.
Anyway. Who have you met? Who have you met that you've just went, oh, I can't believe I'm meeting this person?
Woody Allen and Neil Simon.
You met Woody Allen?
Yeah.
Where? When? Tell me.
Peter Boyle.
Yeah.
Peter Boyle. He used to take me to, like, I was a retarded kid. He used to, thank you, man. He would take me to Knicks games. He had season tickets.
So hang on. So the Peter Boyle that played Frankenstein in Young Frankenstein.
Right. We became friends when I was a valet at his place called the River Cafe in Brooklyn. And he came up to, and he went to the same grade school and high school I went to.
Right.
But he was older than me, but I knew his father was Uncle Pete, the TV show, kids show host.
All right.
Uncle Pete Boyle, and all the kids loved him, you know.
Yeah.
And so Peter Boyle comes up, and I say to him, hey, man. He goes, hi. I said, hey, you're from St. Francis de Sales, right? And I didn't say you're Peter Boyle or anything. You're from Second City or all the stuff you did. And he goes, how did you know that? I said, well, I know you went to West. You lived at 51st and Hazel. He goes, who are you? And then I started telling him, and then we became friends. And that's how I got we were friends. I really liked the guy, great actor.
And so he introduced you to Woody Allen?
Well, no. I was just at this executive suite where the Knicks like higher ups and their celebrity people go to hide, and I was just looking at the buffet, and Lorne Michaels came in, and I don't know if you ever met Lorne Michaels, but I'm sure he's very nice to people he likes,
right?
But he's a really snotty, he's kind of like a faggy straight guy, prissy, you know, like, I mean, amazing accomplishments, but, you know, just not like. So I said to him, to be polite, I said, hi, Lauren, I'm Dom Irrera. He goes, I know who you are. And I just wanted to grab that motherfucker and just throw him into the potato salad. But I didn't. I just walked away. And then I just showed you how life can change in a couple of steps. I walk over, and there was this woman, Jean Demanian, who was good friends of Woody Allen, who had got Saturday Night Live for a little bit. And she actually hired me for a few episodes a long time ago. And she walks in with Woody Allen. She goes, Dom, do you know Woody? I go, no. And then he goes like this. He doesn't look me in the eye. He looks me in the shoulder. He goes, I really like your work. And I thought, Woody Allen likes my work.
Right? Wow.
Yeah. He knows me. That he even knows me. And that was that and the Neil Simon thing, same kind of thing. I was on an elevator in Aspen. Neil Simon gets on. And he goes, I like what you do, man. I said, thank you. I said, you're Neil Simon, the most prolific playwright of the 20th century. What am I going to say to you? Keep up the good work? And you know what he said? He goes, that's exactly what you say.
Wow.
Because I mean? You know, he's not dead.
Yeah,
you're not going to say, oh, I used to like all your stuff. Like, you know, he's still current. And
yeah. Dude, what it just, isn't it, mate, like, in a way, what Lorne Michaels and Woody Allen said to you were almost exactly the same thing. Like, I know who you are. There's such a difference between, I know who you are, and I really like
I was just trying to be nice, you know?
Yeah, of course.
You ever get people and you introduce them to somebody and they go, like, I don't know him. I met him 20 times. I'm sorry, I was trying to be polite.
Yeah. You know? Wow, what should I just not introduce you and hope? There are certain people I can't imagine meeting, and Woody Allen would be one of them.
Yeah.
Have you ever, a friend of mine auditioned for him.
I walked by him. All you had to do was walk by him, and I was so glad that I didn't get the part because it was Stardust Memories, and they were walking people by, and he was looking for freaky looking people.
Right.
Kind of ugly people.
Yeah.
So luckily, I wasn't ugly yet, but that was the only time I never really read for him or anything.
Do you know what's interesting is watching that documentary on the way over, his... The woman that does all the casting for him, she has a board of
photos. What's her name?
I can't remember. Yeah, not his sister. His sister's the other producer.
Nettie.
Yes, Nettie is his sister. But she has a board of what she calls Woody Allen extras. And she just, whenever she casts or meets someone with an interesting or weird-looking face, she goes, oh, Woody will love him in a film one day.
Right.
But apparently his auditions are that. He'll just, like, 10 seconds, he'll just look at them and go, thank you.
When I kidded you about Sean Penn, I really do know him, and I got a Woody Allen tie-in with that. Sean Penn has a great memory.
Right.
And I've known him since Ridgemont High. He used to come to the Comedy Store.
Right.
And it's not like we're friends, but we're friendly. And he comes up to me after a set at the Improv, and he goes, he starts talking to me about material, old material, new material, you know. And he got incredible retention. And I said to him, all right, if I'm going to answer questions about, you got to answer questions to me about Woody Allen.
Right.
He says, all right. I said, okay. What was it like working with him? He said, he gave me one note. Remember he did Dirty Lowdown?
Sweet and Lowdown, yeah.
Right? What was it like working for him? He goes, he gave me one note the whole movie. I said, what was that? He goes, that last scene you did, nothing was right. that was his whole note. So...
He's in the documentary. They talk to Sean Penn about it.
Oh yeah.
And he said the first scene that he did for Woody, he hadn't been rehearsing and they hadn't kind of talked through the character or anything. So he did it, and he got to the end of the scene and he said he looked up with a look on his face of, should I book my ticket home? I think his exact words were, should I book window or aisle on my way home tomorrow?
Oh, he thought he was getting fired.
Just to look up, and he said, not only did Woody Allen not say anything complimentary, or he had just turned away to get ready for the next scene.
Wow.
That was it. Just,
yeah.
He knows what he wants.
What is it? ABC is here.
NBC is upstairs.
Okay.
What are you?
Do they want both of us? What?
Just you.
Okay. We'll be done in a minute. We're wrapping up.
Do you know what? We could even talk about that. Like, that's interesting. What's going on here? The interviews that you're doing today for NBC and ABC.
Yeah, you want to explain it?
Yeah. Okay, so from what I can tell, this is what I've been brought up to date with, is that Daniel Tosh turned up. Was it here?
Yeah.
Dom was on stage. Daniel Tosh, for those outside of America, Daniel Tosh is a big comedy star over here at the moment.
Tosh.0 is the name of the TV show he has. And he's a great comedian.
Yeah.
And I wasn't on stage. I was on stage earlier.
Oh, right.
I was on stage. I didn't bring him up. I told them to bring him up.
Right. And so then someone from he ended up on stage. He hadn't planned to do a set.
Tremendous ovation.
Yep. And then some woman took him to task for making a joke about rape.
Right.
And said rape's not funny.
Rape's
not funny. And it got ugly. Did it get ugly?
Apparently it got a little ugly, but she's a writer. And so she went to the press and made this big thing about it. And what we were talking about earlier with the network people is how we walk the line on comedy, and there's certain things that could offend people, and we don't really mean to hurt people. We're trying to make them laugh, but through that, I mean, you said something really much more eloquent than the way I'm putting it about the boundaries.
And I think people like it when you push the boundaries,
right?
And you get the guilty laugh, the oh my god, that's wrong, but I'm laughing.
Yeah. Oh, I can't believe I'm laughing at that.
Yeah. And then suddenly you push it a bit more and they go, oh, I can't believe I'm laughing at that. That's so wrong. And then you push it one more step and they go, that is just wrong. And you go, wow, I've gone too far now.
Now I'm offended,
And when you're not famous, you can do that. But when you're famous, soon as you take that
step. Once you hit the top, they want to knock you off.
Do you know what? There's an interesting thing that happened in Australia yesterday, and I noticed it on the news last night. Wayne Brady from, Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Right.
Was in Perth. And before the show, they say to the audience, if you've got any questions for Wayne, write them down. So he was on stage and he went through, and one of the questions, just stupid, what's it like being a black man? And he kind of went, that's stupid. And then the next one, it was, how black are you?
Right.
And
not that black on a scale of, if that's what they mean by stereotypes.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it was awkward in the room, and it was reported the next day in the Australian press of, oh my God, Australians are so racist and how terrible is this?
Oh, jeez.
But was it 4 days ago? Bill Maher made a joke saying he wishes Barack Obama was more like Suge Knight, the you know, the rapper, the death, right. I can't think of the name of the company that he founded. Anyway, you know, gun-toting, hooker-killing type guy. He said, I wish Obama was more like him and less like Wayne Brady. So Wayne Brady is now kicked off going, what, am I not, I'm not the right type of black for you? Well, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
So it's entirely possible that this guy in the audience in Australia had picked up on that and was making a reference to it, albeit misjudged.
Oh, well, you will never please everybody. I mean, we'll never, you know, they'll always. I did a movie called Hollywood Shuffle once, and it was about black stereotypes.
Yeah.
You could say that about a lot of us, you know, like, you know, the stereotype we get from Australia is the ex-cons.
Yeah, yeah.
Always drinking, always eating barbecues. It's like, you know, I've been there. A lot of the stereotypes are true.
And it's always that thing if we well, it is. And if we make that joke about ourselves, it's funny.
Yeah.
But if an American makes that joke, then we go, oh, man, you're just being ignorant. You don't know what we're like.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, have you ever seen that? There's a Simpsons episode where they go to Australia.
No.
And
I love the Simpsons.
In retrospect, everyone in Australia watched it and went, we are so not like that. You know, it's like they meet the Prime Minister of Australia and he's, yeah, how you going? And killing a dingo or something. But clearly it's a bunch of Americans going, we know you're not like that.
Yeah,
we're
right.
We're just pretending that that's what we think.
No, we love Australia. You know that. We do. I mean, this is one of the few countries that likes us. We don't have that many friends left. Adam, thank you so much, my brother. I love you. And your family, I love. So thanks for being on the show.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Good
Adam Hills.
Thank you.
Dom Irrera signing off, live at the Laugh Factory. Ooh, is this thing on? Thanks, buddy. If she had only been up.